Good morning, students. Yesterday we have started new lesson, first umpires. So in this lesson we have discussed about Mauryan dynasty or empire. So what is called empire? Empire means the large kingdom is called the empire, and the large kings who ruled the large kingdoms are called emperors. So we discussed in the previous class about Mauryan empire. So in the Mauryan empire, who are the major kings? So Chandragupta Maurya and the Ashoka. So Ashoka was the one of the unique ruler and famous king in our country. So today let us discuss about kingdoms and empires in the Deccan area. So which is called Deccan area? The South India. Almost South Indian area is called the Deccan Plateau. Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala. So comes under Deccan Plateau. At the time of Mauryan period, so Mauryans conquered the Deccan areas from Godavari river to Krishna Tungabhadra river valley. Between these rivers, that area was conquered by, won by Mauryans. So at that time in this region, a large parts of the region developed village settlements and small towns, and they used iron tools to do agriculture, and they prepared iron tools and sold in at these areas. In some areas they also have gold mines, and they prepared ornaments with the gold and they sold. And in the other areas, most people have been lead their lives by hunting the animals, and they graze the animals, okay, and they lived in a small settlements. So each these areas, already we learnt about Koyas and tribes in the previous classes. They have a headman to solve the disputes among the people. So these are people belongs to close relatives, and each other through birth and marriage. Such groups are called clans. Okay, so some important person among these clans may have emerged as powerful headmen who lead them and settle their internal disputes. Those are called headmen or patla. So they gradually grow wealthy and powerful and ruled the clan area. Okay, the headman is the chairman of that clan. So after the Mauryan empire, after Mauryans became weak, so these clan headmans became the small kings of those clans, as of those areas. So out of those people, the Satavahanas, who managed to build a large kingdom which extended from the banks of Narmada river to the Krishna Godavari delta. So after the Mauryans, in Deccan area, the Satavahanas became the kings or emperors in our area. Okay, so the most important Satavahana kings were Gautamiputra Shatakarni, Vasishtaputra, Pulamavi, and Yajnasri Shatakarni. So these three were the most popular kings in Shatavahana Empire in Dakkan area. Okay, they ruled this area about 200 years and around 2000 years ago. So these kings were made Danyakataka, built Danyakataka on the banks of River Krishna near Amaravati, their capital. So where is the Amaravati? Yeah, the capital city of Andhra Pradesh. Amaravati is the now capital city of Andhra Pradesh. There these Shatavahana kings were constructed Danyakataka on the banks of River Krishna near Amaravati. That was the capital of Shatavahanas. Okay, these Shatavahanas also tried to bring various clan headmen and small kings under their control, and they allowed them to function within their clan areas without any interference. They had given a powers to these headmans, but they should obey the orders of the Shatavahanas. Okay, so these all villages are the part of the Shatavahana Empire. Many of these headmen and women of their families, traders, etc., contributed to the Buddhist monasteries and suptas, stupas built in Amaravati, Battiprolu, Vadlamanu, etc. So these headmen and women of these clan or families or traders also donated some amount to construct stupas in Amaravati, Battiprolu and Vadlamanu areas. And they donated lands to Brahmins and Buddhist monks also. So these lands were made tax free, means the Brahmins and Buddhist monks need not to pay tax to kings. And at that time they maintained relation with different countries like Rome. They did trade with distinct places from Bengal to Rome also. So at that time we found different coins, including Roman and pots made by Roman style in these areas. Okay, next, Kotilingala in Shatavahana times. Where is the Kotilingala area? Kotilingala is situated at the junction of Pedavagu and River Godavari in Jagityala district in Telangana. Where it is? In Telangana, beside the Godavari banks. So it was constructed. So this is located side of Sripada Yellampalli project. So it was the capital of Ashmaka Janapada. Ashmaka Janapada. Janapada already we discussed. Janapada means one area is called where the people settled. That is called Janapada. So one of the Janapada of 16 Mahajanapadas of ancient India. So this Ashmaka was the one of the big Janapadas out of 16. It was the first capital city of Shatavahana dynasty. So Kotilingala was the first capital city of Shatavahana dynasty. Dynasty means empire. Okay, so during the archaeological excavations, we found a number of silver and gold coins in this area, and Shatavahana period coins and Ikshvaku period coins also we found in this area. And we found antiquities such as pottery, terracotta, some ceramic metal tools we found in this area, and a ring well constructed with clean bricks was also found in this area. Okay, next. Besides Kotilingala stupas, viharas, chaityas of Buddhist monks are found at Pangiri, Nelakondapalli, Kondapur, Dhulikatta, Peddabankur and Kesaragutta in Telangana state. We can find these stupas and all those in these areas also. Okay, next. How did the headman of some clans become small kings? You will see. So sometime after the end of the Shatavahana kingdom. Okay, first after Mauryans, Shatavahanas became the kings. So after Shatavahanas, who became the kings? Ikshvakas. After Shatavahana kingdom, Ikshvakas established their kingdom. Their capital was Vijayapuri, which was probably located near Nagarjuna Konda on the banks of River Krishna. So they ruled from Vijayapuri, from their capital. Okay, near Nagarjuna Sagar project. So the important kings of this dynasty, Ikshvaka dynasty, are Shantamula and Veera Purusha Datta. These two were the most famous kings in Ikshvaka Empire. So they also tried to bring together the various headmen and the small chiefs by marrying people from other tribes. Okay. Next, they performed some yajnas also, Ashwamedha Yaga, Vajpayee, etc. And they made donations to Brahmins. They also claimed to be the descendants of Lord Rama of the Ramayana. So, they believed that those were the descendants, means heirs of Lord Rama of the Ramayana. So the Ikshvaka women from their family donated some lands and ornaments to Buddhist saints to construct stupas. Okay, next. Some important empires of the Indian subcontinent. Already we discussed about Mauryans, Shatavahanas and Ikshvakas. Okay. In addition to these, we can discuss another important empires in our India. Who are those? Kushans. So Kushans originally migrated from China and gradually established their empire in Afghanistan. And they ruled Afghanistan more than 200 years ago. So they came from China and first they established their empire in Afghanistan 200 years ago. So and they started expanding their kingdom. So the famous Kushana king was the Kanishka. Kanishka, who ascended the throne in 78 CE. They controlled a large part of territory in present day of Pakistan, Afghanistan and India up to Mathura and Allahabad. So under Kushans, Pakistan, Afghanistan and some parts of the India also there. So besides the large part of the Afghanistan, the Kushans also controlled regions up to the Oxus River. So Oxus River was it is flowing from between Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, and some countries in Asia. So almost this river flows 2000 kilometers. So they controlled major trade routes passing between India, China, Iran, and Rome. So it is the time, it was the time the trade was get more importance. So the trade done between the countries and the movement was started between the countries, and the movement of religious preachers, scientists, and artists also happened between these countries. People across these countries came to know about each other, their customs, religious and philosophical thinking, their art and building style, besides of course of buying each other's produce. So because of trade, the people know about each other, and they exchanged their customs and religious and philosophical thinking also. As a result of this trade, urban centers all over India expanded and gold flowed into India. Okay, that is the Kushans empire. Next, Gupta empire. Next one is Gupta. So the Gupta dynasty kings began their rule of a small kingdom in modern Bihar, and within three generations gained control over most of northern India, from Gujarat to Bengal and Delhi to present day Madhya Pradesh. Okay, they established their kingdom from west to east, west to east in the northern states. Some of the most famous kings of this dynasty were Chandragupta I, Samudragupta, Chandragupta II, Kumaragupta, and Skandagupta. So these were the famous kings in the Gupta Empire. So at that time, Gupta kings were introduced to major developments in Indian political system. So two different system they introduced in our political system. What are those? First one, when they conquered a new kingdom, they allowed the old king to continue to rule on the condition that they accept the superior status of the Gupta kings and follow their orders. So in the previous, after conquering any kingdom, so the kingdoms were looted or merged with these, merged with the their kingdoms. But here Guptas not merged the conquered kingdoms into their kingdoms. They allowed the old kings to continue to rule the same kingdom. Okay, this is the one major change. And second one is, secondly, some these Gupta kings and many of their subordinate kings and kings friendly to them gave villages to Brahmins with full administrative rights. So they donated, not only Gupta kings and friends of Gupta kings, subordinate of Gupta kings also donated lands to or villages to Brahmins with full administrative rights. What is the meaning of full administrative rights? So to whom those villages donated, the Brahmins need not to pay any tax to the kings, and they need not to obey the orders of the provincial officers. So they have the autonomous power, full powers. So like that, the Guptas were donated villages to Brahmins. So the Brahmins settled in these villages and performed yagnas and taught Vedas to young Brahmins, Kshatriyas and Vaishyas. They taught Itihasas, Puranas to all. So like that, the Brahmins enjoyed that areas. So Meharali pillar, we'll see here one pillar, iron pillar, which is in Delhi. So the famous Meharali iron pillar, now in Qutub Minar complex in Delhi, was probably set up by Chandragupta II. So at the time of Guptas, they established this, who was also called Vikramaditya. This pillar is famous for the fact that it has not rusted despite standing in open air for the last 1700 years. Usually the iron tools get rust, but this pillar not rusted since 1700 years. That much quality was there. Okay, so the Gupta kings were also grant great patterns of Vedic religious and practices like Ashwamedha sacrifice, and also they constructed so many temples to Vishnu and Shiva, Lord Vishnu and Shiva, and Durga also. Okay, they followed Vishnuism and Shivaism. They allowed the people to follow the Vishnuism and Shivaism also. The Gupta kings also patronized and gave grants to Buddhist stupas like Sanchi Stupa and Jaina monasteries. So these Gupta kings were constructed beautiful temples near different states. So Deoghar and Udaygiri in Madhya Pradesh, Bitragon and Iran in Uttar Pradesh. So these are the beautiful temples were constructed by the Guptas. They contain some of the most beautiful stones sculpture made in India. While these were dedicated to Vishnu and Shiva, the Gupta period is also famous for some of the best sculptures of the Buddha from Saranath. So like that, so new kingdoms were emerged in our country. Mauryans, Chalukyas, Shatavahanas, Chauhans and Gupta kingdoms. Clear? Okay, by this lesson is completed. So read the lesson thoroughly. Thank you.